How objective would you say you are? If I ask you how you like your wine, you might answer sweet or dry. You're unlikely to say expensive. Yet time and again, it's been shown that our palate is influenced by price, even when cheap fizz is mislabeled as prestige cuvée. This is down to a fundamental fact of human psychology. We're not great at objectivity, but over time, we have found ways to compensate for this weakness, the greatest example being scientific research. Through double-blind trials, control groups, and anonymous peer reviews, science grounds itself in cold, hard data, guaranteeing its findings are objective, unbiased, and fair. At least, that's the idea. The reality is more complicated. Take the pulse oximeter, a medical device that clips onto a patient's fingertip and gauges how much oxygen is in their blood by measuring the light that passes through their skin. The less light, the more oxygen. Sounds good. Science and engineering working hand in hand to ensure better health for everyone. The thing is, though, the pulse oximeter doesn't work equally well for everyone. All skin contains a chemical named melanin. The more your skin has, the darker it is, and the less light gets through it. But a pulse oximeter interprets that as a higher oxygen level. So if you have darker skin, you're more likely to be misdiagnosed. Now, the data this device was built on must have been accurate, otherwise it wouldn't work at all. But given science's supposed objectivity, how can a piece of medical equipment have an apparent racial bias? This is the result of what's known as a data gap, a sinkhole that opens up when our data isn't wrong, it's just incomplete. In this case, the design was based on data gathered from too narrow a range of skin tones, which didn't cover the broad spectrum of people who would use it. But this is far from an isolated example. Data gaps are startlingly common, can take many forms, and their effects can be life-threatening. Take medical trials. These involve collecting data on how safe and effective a treatment is, in cell samples, then animals, then three phases of human trials, before finally being approved for use. This process employs every objectivity hack we can muster to ensure the results aren't slanted by the placebo effect or other human foibles. And for the most part, it works well. We have the drugs and vaccines to prove it, but it isn't without its flaws. Imagine a drug is being trialed on an equal number of men and women. The results show that the same dosage causes side effects in 3% of men but 15% of women, a difference which is obvious when the data is broken down by sex. But here's the thing, all too often, it isn't. Instead, all the data gets lumped together, bringing the average side effect rate down to 9%. Technically correct, but kind of misleading. It gets worse, though, because most drug trials aren't an equal male-female split. And if we adjust our numbers to be more realistic, 70% men, 30% women, then the overall side effect rate drops to 6.5%, seriously underplaying the potential risk to women. This isn't just hypothetical. In 2013, the US Food and Drug Administration changed the recommended female dose for the insomnia drug Ambien after it was found that women's bodies are 5 times more likely than men's to retain dangerous levels of it the next day, increasing drowsiness and the risk of accidents. This had been completely missed when the drug was first approved 21 years earlier. And while in this case the data gap was eventually corrected, there's plenty of evidence that this kind of oversight isn't the exception, but the rule. In her 2019 book, Invisible Women, writer and campaigner Caroline Criado Perez examines the impact of data gaps on almost every aspect of women's lives around the world. From tax systems to office culture to urban planning to disaster relief, the scale of the problem is staggering. Elsewhere, we see the effects of data gaps in facial recognition systems that struggle to recognize particular ethnicities, or speech recognition that can't understand many accents. Besides the scope of this issue, what these examples demonstrate is that data gaps don't crop up at random. They map pre-existing inequalities within society. This isn't to say that scientists, doctors, and engineers are prejudiced monsters plotting to make the lives of already disadvantaged groups harder, just that even when conscious attitudes have changed, institutional practices often lag behind, resulting in data gaps that reflect, then reinforce, inequalities we might like to think we've moved past. This problem doesn't have one simple solution. Some progress will be legal, like recent US and EU regulations requiring the inclusion of women in medical trials. But elsewhere, it's going to be down to individuals and institutions to realize the benefits of inclusivity, not just among those being researched, but also among the researchers, and all the way up to the executive level. Because data gaps don't only exist in labs. Anywhere decisions are made by a non-diverse group of people, there's a potential data gap problem. And ultimately, only by celebrating our diversity and questioning what passes for objectivity can we ensure that science and technology benefit everyone equally.